How's it going, everybody? Welcome back to the channel. So, it's been around a year since I finished What If Goku Remembered His Saiyans, and as much as I'd like to dive into the Granola arc, it's not finished yet. So, instead of heading straight into that arc, I figured we could move on into a GT edition of this scenario, as you guys seem to like those pretty well. Now, if you're subscribed to me, I'm pretty sure you've seen the What If Goku Remembered His Saiyans movie, but if you're somehow new here and never checked it out, then make sure to click the link up above to watch the movie before you head into this part. For this GT edition, we're going to be continuing the story after the events of Super, since that would just make for a more cohesive story. If you like this video and want to see more like it, let's see if we can get this part to 500 likes. As if we can hit that, then I'll make sure to make more like it. With all that out of the way, let's dive right back into What If Goku Remembered His Saiyans. Feels good to say that again. It's been quite a few years since the defeat of Moro, and all of our warriors are living to life now. Kakarot, Raditz, and Piccolo have been training up on Kami's lookout for some time, trying their hardest to get more powerful than before. In this time, Kakarot has been able to master his Ultra Instinct form, and can use it to totally wipe out any opposition that get in their way. He doesn't use it all the time, since if he does, it's not really fair to his training partners, but just remember that he can use it. Bardock is a retired man, as his rapid aging has caught up with him, so he's just chilling around his Gine for the remainder of his days. He still keeps to himself with his training, but at a much lesser degree so he doesn't kill himself early. Vegeta is still the ruler of the Saiyan race on Earth, and has had his daughter, Princess Bra, in this time with Bulma. He's doing a great job as ruler, though does want to pass the rulership down to Trunks one of these days. Not quite yet though, as Trunks is still pretty young, and he wants him to train to get a new form more powerful than his new Super Saiyan 3 before he takes over. Things are going great for all of our Saiyans on Earth, and things are pretty much looking up. That is until Pilaf and the gang arrive at the lookout and attempt to summon Ultimate Shenron. Of course, Kakarot goes to stop them as he did in GT, but gets turned back into a child. Kami and Piccolo apprehend the gang, and before they can comprehend that Kakarot has turned back into a child, Shenron departs. Kami has a heart attack after seeing that the Black Star Dragon Balls were used, and Raditz is more concerned on how his brother's become a little kid again. Kami explains to the group that he hid away those Dragon Balls for a reason, as once somebody uses a wish on them, then the planet is going to explode in a year. The group is shocked to hear this and wonder what it is they can do to stop this. Kami says the only way to prevent the planet's destruction is to go into space and gather up all the balls. Kakarot says he doesn't mind being like this for now, he'll do what he can to help get the Black Star Dragon Balls back and save the planet. After having a meeting with King Vegeta and Bulma, Bulma decides that she's gonna build a new ship. That way the others can explore space and be able to find the Black Star Dragon Balls. Unlike in GT though, Kakarot isn't gonna have to bring the kids along, as Raditz and Piccolo already want to go along with him, as they feel it'll be the smart thing to do. Kakarot has been affected in his strength by him reverting back into a kid, and it'll be pretty hard for him to go all out on his own and babysit more kids. So why make the trip harder than it has to be, and bring along two adults to go on this dangerous trip instead? Yes, that was a dig at GT's stupid opening plot. Bulma completes the new ship in no time, and Goku, Raditz, and Piccolo all step inside to go on the grand tour and save the planet. Now, since the beginning of GT is literal cancer, I'm just gonna be skimming through it if that's cool. Luckily, since there isn't a pan here, things won't be as bad anyways. But we also have an extremely powerful Raditz and Piccolo here, who are way better than what Trunks and Pan were in canon, so there really won't be that many threats. So, let's do a speedrun. The three are able to go through a mecha with no issues really. Legic is taken out in literally no time at all, and the people kinda stay as slaves since the group doesn't stick around long enough to help them out. Sorry, Amekians. They get the ball on the weird bee planet and beat the crap out of that Zanuma guy instead of trying to marry him, when one of the Parapara brothers tries to take the Dragon Ball. Piccolo smacks him in the end to stop him from taking off, and they interrogate the brothers to force them to reveal their hideout. No Parapara dance. On planet Lude, they easily take on the Whipmaster dude, then the whip itself, and finally get to move on to Lude himself. I don't know why that was so complicated in the show. The Lude battle would be piss easy, as these three are so strong now, that I'm pretty sure Raditz could just sneeze and Lude would explode. With Lude dead and the Dragon Ball secured, the gang then heads off to the Machine Mutant planet to encounter the Machine Mutants themselves. Sure, everybody's super strong now, but that knockout gas of course does the trick, and they are captured by General Rieldo. Of course, once they come to, they immediately power up and begin their assault. The Sigma Force is taken out quickly while General Rieldo proves to be somewhat of a challenge. Piccolo is able to handle it pretty well, until he is Han Solo'd and shipped off to Dr. Mew. Goku and Raditz find out in revenge, and are surprised to see that this guy is actually part of the planet itself. Though, as Super Saiyans, they can easily hold him down. Eventually, they're all sent to Dr. Mew, but once they uncover his plans, he's easily bested, and Baby is destroyed. Or so they think. The three may have been able to take down Dr. Mew, but Baby isn't going to be taken down that easily, and he goes off to battle him once more as that weird child, and then departs for Earth. Hey everybody, sorry to interrupt the video, but it's sponsorship time. This video is sponsored by Fandom Ion, who sells some really great anime and manga merch, and a bunch of other cool merch for some pretty cool prices, such as Marvel merch as well for all you Marvel nerds like me. If you want to get these fine items for an even lower price, then make sure you click the link in the description down below and put in the discount code Damon for not 5% off, but 10% off of your order. Again, that's code Damon for 10% off of your order. Hopefully, you won't regret your purchases. Now, let's get back into the video. Once Baby makes his way to the planet, he realizes how the Saiyan race isn't extinct after all. They just managed to migrate to an unknown planet. These filthy Saiyans, the ones who completely destroyed the Tuffles, are thriving. He'll make sure to get to them as well, and make sure that the Saiyans are the ones who are extinct next. Baby infiltrates the Saiyan capital, and begins to slowly take over the weaker Saiyans, and make his way up to the castle with his new army. Baby starts to go for the stronger guards who have achieved Super Saiyan states or further, and is able to take them over and really let the remainder of the Saiyans have it. Eventually, he comes face to face with Trunks, and makes sure to go after him. Trunks is able to fight off at least two of the guards by himself, but once the whole Saiyan race is after him, he gets taken over as well. Vegeta realizes that something terrible is happening in a castle, and goes to investigate, and is bombarded by an army of Saiyans. Vegeta tells Nappa to get Bulma out of here, and he'll hold them all off. Vegeta is shocked to see that his son has been taken over by some weird machine mutant, and fights it out with him to protect Bulma. Nappa and Bulma escape, as Vegeta powers up into his godly, wrathful Super Saiyan state to wreck the baby-infected Saiyans coming after him. Vegeta is able to knock away many of the Saiyans and make sure not to kill any of them, as he can sense that they're not themselves. Luckily, since Vegeta is so powerful in this state, none of the infected Saiyans can cut him at all, and Baby Trunks is forced to retreat to find a stronger body to get Vegeta under his influence. Baby follows Nappa over to the Sun household, where he sees Bardock and Gine. These Saiyans look pretty old, and he's surprised that they have managed to live this long, as most Saiyans never make it to old age. This Bardock guy looks familiar, too. Maybe he was there that day the Tuffles were destroyed. He can't believe it, a Saiyan he actually remembers. Baby fires a blast at the Sun household to destroy it, and Bardock jumps on Gine to protect her. With the blast disorienting everybody, Baby latches himself onto Bardock and manages to fully possess him. Gine, Bulma, and Nappa look on in fear at Bardock, as Baby says that this body may be old, but it is still full of power, and this is what he needs to take down Vegeta. Nappa attacks Baby as the two begin to battle it out, with Baby surprised at Nappa's Super Saiyan Blue powers. He knows his body has that kind of power as well, though since Bardock is old, it's gonna be lesser. He knows he is still stronger than Nappa though, so he needs to stick with his body for now. With this power, he doesn't even need to defeat Nappa, just cut him so he can take over his body. And once he does, he knows he has more than enough power to take down the others. Bardock and Nappa then take over Gine and Bulma, while they go off to get more Saiyans to their cause. With the element of surprise now, Baby is able to overtake even more Saiyans, and with Bardock's memories, is able to find Broly and Gohan, who are also blue level fighters. Bardock manages to cut them open and take over their bodies, gaining the strongest of allies. This is when Vegeta makes his way to them for help and realizes that he isn't going to be getting any. Baby has taken over too many now. Baby flies to meet Vegeta and transforms to the godly wrathful form to face him. Vegeta has the advantage with his more youthful body, but Baby has the advantage in numbers. He is able to hurt Vegeta bad in just Bardock's body, but once he has Nappa, Broly, or even Gohan come in to fight as well, it's useless to fight back, and eventually, even the King of All Saiyans falls to the might of Baby. Baby has managed to take over the entire Saiyan population, and the whole planet. Eventually, Kakarot, Raditz, and Piccolo make their way back to the planet with all of the Black Star Dragon Balls, and once they go to hand them over to Kami, Piccolo can immediately sense that something is wrong. He is still connected to Kami and realizes that this isn't him. Kami realizes that they're onto him and tries to escape, but Piccolo takes him down and asks who this person is and what he's done to Kami. Kami laughs, saying that they are Baby, and with their might, the mighty Saiyan race will finally fall. The group can't believe it once they hear Baby, as there's no way he could have made it to Earth. Before they go back down to help their loved ones, a blast hits the lookout directly, shaking up everybody. Bardock, Gine, and Nappa fly up to them, laughing that they've arrived on the planet too late. Goku and Raditz transform into their god states to hold back their parents and friends, but they don't want to push it, as their parents are old and can't take the hits that they used to. Bardock thinks it's hilarious how they're holding back, and amps it up more to fight with the Saiyans. Kakarot wants to quickly knock them out with Ultra Instinct, but in his kid body, he's not able access to power right away, as it'll put too much of a strain on him. Raditz can still go blue, but it's useless as they all gang up on him and overtake him as well. Piccolo's able to somewhat resist being overwhelmed, and leases to Mafuba to get all of the baby-infected Saiyans off of Kakarot. Piccolo then flies over to Kakarot, and they kai-kai over to Supreme Kai's world. Once there, Kakarot says they need to go back, since they can't just let Baby destroy the planet once more with the Black Star Dragon Balls. Piccolo says there's not a whole lot they can do, as with him being a kid and them having no allies, there's nothing. Beerus and Whis can't even help them either, as they'd probably just kill their friends instead of freeing them. Kakarot says that's true and doesn't know what else to do. But the Supreme Kai tells him that they have the sacred water on Earth he can use to free everybody under Baby's control, though he can't just go and grab it as the infected will certainly take him over. Kakarot says that can be the plan to get everybody out of his control, but with his strength there's no way that he can take them all on. Then he has an idea, as while Beerus and Whis may not be able to help them in fighting, maybe they can help in another way. Kakarot and Piccolo kai-kai over to Beerus' planet, and they explain to Whis that they need their help. Whis is shocked to see that Kakarot is stuck in a child's body now, and Beerus is disgusted by what has become of him. Goku is supposed to be his greatest rival, and he certainly can't be if he's stuck in that gross kid body of his. Beerus demands that Whis grow Goku back up, and Whis bonks his staff on Kakarot's head to turn him into an adult once more. Kakarot is very happy that Whis could actually do that, and tells him thanks, but he can't stick around to chat. Kakarot then closes his eyes and powers up into his mastered Ultra Instinct form, and kai-kais over to the new planet Tuffle to encounter Baby Vegeta. Baby looks on at Kakarot, saying it's surprising how he went from being a little kid to an old man with gray hair. Kakarot tells Baby to release all the people under his hold now, and he'll let him live. Baby says that's hilarious, and it isn't gonna happen. He assigns Kakarot's family to power up to their strongest and fight him, as he's not really in the mood. Kakarot blitzes Gine, Nappa, and Raditz, making sure to only knock them out. Baby is shocked to see Kakarot take these guys out so fast, and make sure Bardock pushes his body to his limits with the blue wrathful form. Kakarot and Bardock fight, with Bardock being able to actually hold off Kakarot in this form. Kakarot really wants to go easy on his father, but since he's so powerful, he can't just one-shot him like he did with the others. Kakarot still needs to stick with the plan though, and fires at Baby Vegeta to get him to join in too. Baby Vegeta complies with being able to take this Saiyan down, and powers up into his own wrathful blue form to battle. Kakarot has mastered the Ultra Instinct transformation, and is very good with dodging Baby's blows, but having both of these blue wrathful Saiyans after him is more than enough to put MUI on the back foot. Luckily, Kakarot is succeeding in distracting Baby, as Piccolo and Shin are flying around the planet, dumping the cure on all the infected babies. Baby can tell that something is terribly wrong and turns around to see that the infected Saiyans are all turning back into themselves again. He curses Kakarot for distracting him and goes to fire him away, until Raditz blasts it out of the air and tells Baby he doesn't think so. He's back to normal, and him and his brother are going to take them down for good. Piccolo launches a special beam cannon at Baby and Bardock to keep them occupied, as he throws down to Patara, to Kakarot, and Raditz, telling them to put it on now. The two Saiyans look at the earrings and remember how powerful Black and Hit got when they fused with the Patara, and realize with this, they'll be able to take Baby down and save everyone. Kakarot and Raditz fuse together into Raditz. As Raditz, the fusion can use Godly Ki, and a UI Omen of Ultra Instinct. They can't use the Mastered variant as Raditz was never able to get UI, but with the Kakarot part of the fusion, Raditz can use Omen. This is more than enough for Baby, as Raditz attacks both him and Bardock. Bardock is able to be taken down pretty fast, and freed from Baby by Piccolo, while Baby Vegeta is the last parasite left. Baby Vegeta tries to fight back, but with the UI Omen Raditz, he stands no chance. Baby decides to eject himself from Vegeta to escape, but once he gets out of the clutches of Raditz, Piccolo stops him in his tracks and fires him back towards the fusion. Raditz grabs Baby and then throws him up into the air, launching a Kamehameha Sunday up to disintegrate Baby. The threat isn't over yet though, as they need to get everybody off of this planet. Raditz and Piccolo kai-kai everyone off the planet, and Piccolo feels no need to sacrifice himself this time, as if he does, then Kami will die too, and they can't let that happen because they don't want to get rid of the actual Dragon Balls. Once everybody is saved, the real Dragon Balls are used to bring back the planet, and everything is finally over. The Black Star Dragon Balls are sealed away, never to be used again, and Kakarot is now an adult and not stupidly stuck in his kid body for the rest of GT. Everything is slowly going back to normal. Though, in hell, something is brewing. We're gonna save that though for next time. Hope you all enjoyed the GT edition of What If Goku Remembered His Saiyans. This one was super fun to write, as I don't get to write GT often, and it's a nice change of pace. If you want to see the next part of the scenario sooner rather than later, let's see if we can get this part to 500 likes. So if we can hit that, then I'll make sure to get started on a part 2. Thank you all so much for watching, and until we meet again. See you later!